So I'm quickly going to pull out some of the elements of this story structure. Follows the basic process, quite straightforward, actually. Let's go over basic story architecture first. So you've seen these videos before, you were familiar with this. So when you first start writing a filmmaking, you have a linear perspective in that sense. Pretty soon you realize that both the beginning and the ending are the same, which is why we demonstrate story structure via a loop. We identify the classic beginning and ending, the state of perfection, which is lost, becomes a state of imperfection, the loss phase, the limitations phase, and the process of returning to it is undergone. Basically what you have is the paradise lost, or paradise to paradise lost, Garden of Eden, various symbolism, lots of damage done to reach to this imperfect state. And then the process of returning and becoming whole is undergone. So you can start there or stop there or somewhere in between. If you do that, the events there tend to be referenced at later stages, as in this story. Most stories such as this one end with some form of state of perfection. If you don't want to do that, if you want to end with imperfection or some combination, that's almost the same. The process is always the same. So you're always going to have transformation, change, metamorphosis, transmogrification, the various arcs, psychological journey. You're always going to have physical journey. And you're always moving through new worlds, which are really our physical manifestations of new psychological states, new versions of the self. Working your way around the cycle involves jumping through lots of hoops. Each hoop has its own set of sub-stages, which in essence are functions which may be performed, messages which may be communicated. They tell you what tangibles or intangibles you're going in there to acquire, what symbolism to use, and so forth. So they show you how to construct those sequences. So for example, if that's the ordinary world, we know it's a state of protection, repression, fear of it, etc. So those sub-stages show you how to construct those sequences. When you're here, you're not able to return. You have to go forward, grow, learn, mature, come all the way around until you're ready to return. And that is basic story architecture. It's a fundamental framework that all successful stories are based around. And I go over that in great detail in the 2100 plus stage of the journey transformation, movement through new worlds and states. So let's get rid of that. And let's draw another loop. So we know now there's much more behind that than a simple circle would suggest. So, okay, Jojo Rabbit. Now, classically, we have Jojo, in essence, is almost an orphan. So he's lost his parents. You had a parent death there. He assumes that... Or is led to believe by his mother that his father's gone to fight for Hitler because she doesn't want him to be in danger. So there's been a split in the past between two ways of thinking, two points of view that are represented by Jojo initially. So we have basically our main character or protagonist, if you want, and he is alone. And has an imaginary friend in Hitler. So that, in essence, is a positioning. And Hitler representing a particular point of view or a thematic side of the argument. So he's going to youth camp, and that's where we meet Captain C. And Fraulein Rahm and Finkel and so on, various other characters that have particular archetypal positions. So we find out later, for example, in the near-death experience and the rebirth phase that Captain K is actually thematically aligned with Mother or Rosie. And doing what he can. So he wants to belong somewhere, and he doesn't belong in in the youth group thing, and he's exiled. So he's made fun of because of his parent, because he doesn't want to kill the rabbit, doesn't align to the to norms of that group, is exiled. He blows himself up with the grenade, and then he's in hospital, and that's where we meet Mother, who in essence is a supernatural aid and has a particular point of view and is thematically opposite to Hitler. So you've got two guiding forces there. What we're going to do is we're going to reverse our main character from aligning to Hitler to all the way around the final conflict when he literally boots him out of the window and aligns with the object of demonization here, which is the Jewish people and specifically represented by Elsa. And thematically what we have is Rose, your mother, saying, listen, that she does her best, she does what she can. And that's what her father Jojo's father has left her to do as is made explicit past the Rhoda trials later on. So then the first threshold really begins when Jojo comes back home and he finds Elsa. Complete opposites there. He wants her out of the house, and what we're going to do is we're going to arc him all the way around until the stage of the boon when he completely reverses from that position to that position and sides with her, following the choice that he's got to make. But initially he wants her out and she refuses. Initially, he presents the idea to his mother that Elsa, the Jewish girl, is living upstairs and it doesn't conform to his positioning, his point of view here. And initially, Rose, your mother, pretends not to know, but then ultimately, in the belly of the whale sequences, she is upstairs conferring with Elsa, saying, listen, be quiet, because she doesn't want to have to make a choice between her and her son, that she's doing her best. So again, thematically aligned. And then what we have is Jojo going to Captain K and saying, listen, what do I do if I reveal that she's hiding in the attic? What's going to happen to her? What's going to happen to me? And what's going to happen to Mother? And at this point, he doesn't even believe that Mother is on a separate side. He believes that Elsa has brainwashed his mother. So part of the physical separation, classic Rhoda trial scenario here, or movement. So what we're doing is this separation between Jojo and Elsa, that declines. So we're becoming closer, merging towards the opposite side. Same as with Mother, becoming close. Until this, as we get to the season times, we'll sword save or past the road trial stages, and we see them cycling together. So closer to Elsa, closer to Mother, closer to a particular point of view, and separating at the same time from Hitler, that attachment there, which represents his original position or his ordinary self, and symbolically moving away from Hitler's position. So by the time we come out of the road of trials, by the time we exit, we are friends with Elsa, and so we've moved from this position of being completely opposite to her. And then you've got Mother acting as classically the oracle archetype here, and pushing Jojo towards the sword and the bride theft, so encouraging romance and encouraging the idea that when we get to the sword, that, as Elsa says, he's not a Nazi, he's just a 10-year-old boy who wants to dress up and belong somewhere. And we also have the bride theft, so classic functioning there, so a romantic challenge. This is when Jojo's butterflies appear, and that bride theft in essence is classic here, because Elsa is from the opposite world, is the opposite side, and that bride theft symbolizes merging with that opposite side on various levels. Then we have our near-death experiences of the Gestapo arrive, and we have Captain K demonstrating the thematic statement. So he does what he can and saves Elsa, and that's a point where Hitler becomes quite irate and asks him to make a choice. So that's the point where he's got to choose between the two sides, Hitler's side or Elsa's side and his mother's side. Then we come to the atonement, and actually what's happening is the parent dies, so Rosie, or mother, is hanged, very much like Star Wars, A New Hope, where Ben Kenobi passes, and then you've got the child has to become the parent. And you see that as he starts to become independent, grow up, and one of the signals of that is not being able to tie your shoelace, and then ultimately when he does allow Elsa out, he ties her shoelaces, so symbolically showing that he's growing up to be a man, which is indicated here. Originally, you know, the journey is to mature. It's a maturation. And so, you know, mother dies, and then Jojo has to make a choice, and the choice is Elsa. He sides with her, and at the same time, the city is being bombed. So the world that is represented by Hitler is beginning to dissolve away. And so then, in the morning, he's running around. And on his own, he's scavenging on his own. And mother's gone. He's in essence got nobody except Elsa, who's hiding, and he's doing his best for both of them. And then ultimately we've got the Allies invade, and they take over the city, and the war is won. And he doesn't want to let Elsa go. So this is the opposite from here, go away, to now, you know, lying to keep her, and says that the Germans have won the war. But then ultimately he even lets go of that. So you've got a classic letting go phase where he then conquers his fear. Remember these early stages where Jojo says, listen, is it dangerous outside? Mother says, yes it is. And he's afraid to go outside. Here, he's the one who opens the door, and he's overcome his fear. And he lets Elsa out, and then obviously you've got the freedom to live, which is, as indicated by Mother here, dancing is a symbol of freedom, and at the end they dance. So just a basic pull out of that story structure. If you want a detailed deconstruction, you can order it off the website. But once again, showing you that all of these stories do follow this process of journey and change and transformation and movement through new worlds and states. And I go over that in great detail, again, in the 2100 stage of journey, transformation, movement through new worlds and states. And also in various advanced worksheets where we pull out specific processes.